Hi, I'm Kalki Kekla, and I'm back with a brand new season of Kalki Presents My Indian Life, brought to you by the BBC World Service. It's about being young and Indian in today's world. Now, if you've heard seasons 1 and 2, you'll know that this is about extraordinary real-life stories. And these are amazing people that we get to meet. And I hope that they will inspire you or give you a new perspective on something in life.
I'm going to tell you a story. The story of a college student in Delhi. Let's call her M. Now, M was just a regular young woman from a middle-class family. At least that's what everyone thought. You know, an extrovert, fun-loving adult. But M had a secret life, and she did everything she could to keep it hidden, especially from her family. But don't secrets just have a way of coming out, somehow stumbling out of one's closely guarded life and into the open? It all began when M's parents started getting suspicious about her whereabouts after college. They noticed that their daughter was coming home late nearly every day, and M's explanations didn't really make sense to them. They were certain she was lying. Where was she spending all that time after her classes? Was she in trouble? Was she in a secret relationship? Hard-pressed for answers and sick with worry, they decided to engage a private detective. When I first heard this, my immediate thought was, gosh, I'm glad my parents never did that. Would I go to a private detective to get my own daughter investigated? But for M's parents, this felt like the only way to find answers that they were desperate for. After some searching, they picked Baldev Puri, a private detective who had been practicing in Delhi for nearly 3 decades at that time. They went to his office. Mr. Puri heard them out and agreed to take the case. But he decided that he wasn't going to investigate it himself. He was going to ask his 18-year-old daughter to do it, Tanya.
He told me that he wanted my help.
Now, this wasn't something Tanya was expecting.
At that point, I didn't really understand how I would be of any help to him, but he had to do an investigation on a girl whose parents had come to us and they had to him at that point, and they had said that we doubt that she has an affair with a boy who we don't approve of. So we just want you to monitor her daily activities.
Tanya's father felt that as a college student, Tanya could blend into the crowd on campus quite easily and follow M.
My father told me, why don't you just, for my sake, follow this person's activity alongside my investigator? If you have to step out of the university, he'll be there with you. So just let me know where she's going, what she's doing, who she's meeting.
So Tanya underwent training for a week and then began tailing her target, M, with the help of a senior investigator. The case changed Tanya's life.
And what I saw was obviously beyond and blew my mind.
This first case drew Tanya close to her father's profession, and soon she made up her mind that she would become a private detective after she graduated. And that's exactly what happened. Today, Tanya runs a detective agency, part of her father's business. As a career choice, Tanya's job is thrilling, risky, and I want to say peculiar. This is the story of a young woman who says it's her job to deliver the most bitter truths that one could ever imagine. I'm Kalki Kekla, and I'm back. Yes, this is the start of our 3rd season. From the BBC World Service, this is Kalki Presents My Indian Life, the podcast about being young and Indian in the 21st century. Season 3, Episode 1. Everyone has a secret. So, picture the scene. Here's Tanya, a college student in pursuit of M around the campus, following her father's instructions, making notes about who she's meeting and who she hangs out with. Her father had, in fact, given her a very specific list of instructions.
He told me that very, very minimal you know, rules, but I had to follow them. He said that obviously I would not be going anywhere near the person. It had to be from a certain distance. And he did tell me that you cannot be clicking any photos of her because that's just how it works. We don't click photos of the person doing just about anything. It's when we see evidence is when we're supposed to click. So he told me clearly, don't even let the investigator do so, because a girl could, if at all she ends up seeing us, she could come back to us and say that, you know, you're violating my privacy and you could be behind bars. So we had to be careful about these two things majorly.
When Em left the campus, Tanya, along with the senior investigator, followed her on a motorbike. The first few days, Tanya noticed nothing out of the ordinary. Em was either going to a cafe to meet a friend or to the market for some shopping. It was nothing unusual. On the sixth day of the investigation, though, Em got into a rickshaw and started heading to the north of the city. Tanya and her colleague immediately got on their bike and followed her. The rickshaw started heading into unknown territory, parts of Delhi Tanya had never been to. Was she going to meet the secret boyfriend that her parents were worried about? Suddenly, Em's rickshaw came to a halt. Em paid the fare and started walking. Tanya and her colleague also parked the bike and started to follow her on foot. And Tanya was completely unprepared for what she saw next. Tanya had heard about this part of town, but this was her first time seeing it in person.
There are these small places where basically prostitution happens, and it is not legal, but people know about it. It's like they're aware, but they don't do anything about it. And we were following her, and she went to one of those areas. And when she ended up going there, of course, we couldn't follow her there.
They had to keep their distance from Em. Em could never know that she was being followed.
But we did click photos of her entering that place and going there to give an idea that this is what is happening with your daughter, because our clients were the parents, right?
Once they took the pictures, Tanya's brain was swirling with questions. Was it just a coincidence or misunderstanding? I mean, maybe Em was just meeting someone. Was Tanya just blowing it out of proportion? Or was Em a sex worker? She called her dad immediately and told him everything she had seen. But her journey back to her father's office was solemn and quiet.
Right? So when it happened, she was shocked. She was shocked that she had come and she was saying, Papa, I can't tell you what I have seen and what has been happening in the case.
This is Baldev Puri, Tanya's father. Mr. Puri says he urged her to tell him what she saw. He says he calmed her down and he tried to explain to his child that this was her first case and this was her first time witnessing something like this. He told her these things happen and there are times when you get to see stuff that you've never seen before. But when you do witness such things, don't lose your mind or get disillusioned. This too is a life, and such things do happen. The next day, Tanya's father called Em's parents to his office.
So we went there and we gave them the photos, and eventually we told them that this is what will be happening or might be happening, and they confronted the daughter then. They got her to our office.
Confronted with all the evidence, Em finally broke down and revealed her secret. She confessed that she had turned to sex work because she needed the money.
She just wanted a few outfits from good brands. She had a relationship and she had a friend circle, and they were all very, very affluent in comparison to where they were. And they used to go out to party and they had certain outfits and she didn't. And she just felt that this way she could make extra money. It was through a friend that she had gotten there. And it was willingly that she was doing that.
Em's explanation shocked everyone in that room.
And I think till date, that impacted me the most. And as an 18-year-old, for me, I didn't understand that somebody could go to that extent. I wasn't judging that girl, honestly. Even at that point, I think I've just been raised like that. I mean, I did not judge her, but I felt so much for her. I just thought that if this is a life you're forced to choose because of peer pressure, then what are you doing, you know?
Visibly shocked, Em's parents then took their daughter back home. Neither Tanya nor her father know what happened to them after that. As detectives, they say their job is over once they hand the evidence over to their client. They have little say in what their clients decide to do with it thereafter. Over the course of her life, Tanya has imbibed one lesson about human beings. Everyone harbors a secret.
I honestly feel that everyone, all of us, we hold back on some parts of our personality from even people we love. Not with your husband or partner, but maybe with your mother, from your mother or your father. You could just hold back some part of your personality that you feel might not be entirely accepted. So that's there. But there are some people who hold back and who hold secrets that are so harmful to their relationships. And I feel that that's where we just catch it there. That is what we do. And then we let the people know.
Also, I think culturally in India, I think we have a tendency to hide a lot. Yeah. I mean, I know most of my friends don't tell their parents about half of their life choices, just smoking or in grown-up adults. Yeah.
Just that fear of judgment. And I think it's also not their fault because we've just grown up in this society where parents have so many times would just say, it's okay that we know, don't tell this in front of your uncle, don't tell this. So we just, I think in our hearts, we think that what's the need? Let's just do whatever we want to and let's not tell anybody.
It's interesting talking to Tanya, and I wonder about the ethical dilemma that Tanya's profession evokes. What about a person's right to privacy? Where do you draw the line while investigating someone? For Tanya, the line is pretty clear.
So for instance, when we follow a person's activities, like I said, we do not end up clicking their pictures everywhere they're stopping, because how does that matter to us or to the person who's come to us, you know? Whether they're stopping to buy 5 vegetables and then to a shop to pick up smokes, that's their personality. It's not something that we need to judge them on, assess them with, you know? So, but when, yes, if the client says they need to find whether they're with a woman or a man, and if we do see that, that's when, for evidence, because courts work in a certain way. And any kind of evidence when it's needed, who else would you go to? You can't follow the person yourself because you'll be very visible to the eye. You can't go to the police to have anything because police's work is not this. So it's us.
From Tanya's perspective, this is work. And what she is doing is what her client is authorizing her to do. Of course, with each case, Tanya exercises her judgment when it comes to her client's intentions and the potential consequences of the investigation. The idea, she says, is always to make lives better, not worse. It's been 12 years since Tanya was sent out to investigate her first case. Today, she's a private detective in her own right and with a speciality. She only investigates matrimonial cases, both pre- and post-marital. Along with a network of freelance detectives, most of whom are women, families in New Delhi engage her to find out and deliver uncomfortable truths that could either make or break relationships.
I don't think I'm doing anything ethically wrong because we're not doing anything just by ourselves. It has been assigned to us by someone who has the authority to, which is your partner, mostly. Even your parents don't have the authority to get that done. It's just your partner. So, we do what we're told to do, but obviously following rules that we know we have and the industry allows.
Tanya's dressed in a dapper blue suit with her short hair neatly falling on her shoulders. What strikes me most about her is her composure, especially when she talks about her work. Each case that comes to Tanya is unique, a mini mystery novel with its subplots and secrets that need to be carefully and sensitively unpacked. Through all of them, Tanya has witnessed some of the craziest and strangest things that people have done to each other in the name of love, ambition, desire, greed, and many other things. And Tanya has found herself being asked to play the role of a messenger, and sometimes, in a way, a doctor, administering bitter truths and holding up a mirror to people. Once, a young woman came to Tanya for help. She felt that her boyfriend, a man she'd been seeing for a very long time, was behaving a bit distant with her. She felt that he wasn't close to her mentally, emotionally, or even physically, and she wasn't sure what the problem was. And conversations with him weren't really yielding any answers either.
She didn't think he had an affair. She didn't want us to find any evidence, but she just opened her heart out to us and she wanted me to find a solution. Now, one side of me would just say, that's what do I do here?
So what Tanya decided to do was follow the protocol. She appointed a team to follow the man and find out more about where he goes, who he meets, and what he does. Tanya's team tailed the man for nearly a week, and then...
basically, we just got to know that he was, meeting this woman every day, and she had a child. And he had fallen for her. He just felt disconnected with his girlfriend. He met her at work, the other lady, and he met with her, and he was also like a father to the child now. Emotionally, physically, he just disconnected himself.
Now Tanya has the unenviable job of telling the young woman this harsh truth about her boyfriend.
In my head, I didn't know whether, the man was right, wrong, or whatever, because he wasn't just having an affair for just some physical action or just anything. He was wrong in not telling the girl, but then I just thought that it's okay. My job is to tell the truth, whether right or wrong, doesn't matter. So that's what I did at that point.
And this confrontation, because you always have that moment of confrontation. How do you handle it? Because it's not an easy thing to confront both sides. And there must be a lot of heightened emotions.
Honestly, in the beginning, I was quite impacted. I remember coming back home and having a good cry because I just felt that, why did this woman, her man, have to go through this? But then I think with experience, you get trained to just handle your emotions better in front of people who are already so vulnerable at that point. So whenever there is a certain situation at work like that, I try to be empathetic and console the person, but I don't lose my cool or my emotions so easily now. It's just something I have learned with time. Not that I think that showing emotions is not nice, but I feel that at that point, it's not necessary for me to show my emotions when the situation is already so vulnerable. So that's what I do.
But what happens when an investigator finds herself siding with not her client, but the person she's investigating? This actually happened to Tanya. So this was a few years ago when a couple came to her saying they wanted to get their daughter's fiancé investigated. Their daughter's fiancé, let's call him T, said he was working with his dad, but the couple felt that he was hiding something, and that got them worried. So Tanya put her team on the case. Tanya's team found out that T wasn't actually going that often to his dad's office, which he claimed was where he was working. Instead, he spent a lot of his time making music with a group of his friends. Music meant everything to him, and he actually wanted to pursue that, but he wasn't really able to confess that to his family or his fiancé's family. When Tanya told her clients the truth about T and his love for music, they were very upset. They felt that he was not going to make a lot of money as a musician, and that meant that he would not make a suitable partner for their daughter. Like many Indian parents, their reaction was that he's got to get serious and stick to his dad's business.
I just felt that it was so unfair to that person, because I felt it's all right. I understand that arranged marriages have a certain way of operating and they want to just objectively see the person, their qualifications, the money they have. But I felt like poor guy was just trying to work in his father's business. He hadn't quit. It's just that his mind and heart was somewhere else too. So why don't you give him a chance and maybe explore his personality, That's when I felt that they were just being very...
But you can't say that.
Can't. No, because, maybe while during a conversation could just say that, have you tried meeting him and getting to... So they are very clear, especially I feel when parents come. Not the younger people, but when parents come, they're so strict and stringent about what they want for their daughter and their son that they don't want to see beyond that. Sometimes when the result comes out or when outcomes come, you have to sit them down and say that, see, this is what this person has in him. And yes, this might not be ideal, but this is not bad. You have to sometimes just let them know.
The trick, I'm starting to figure, is knowing when to intervene. Because sometimes private detectives can even end up saving lives. I'm going to tell you a story that kept me on the edge of my seat when I first heard it. There was a time when a lady came to Tanya to get her husband investigated. She was sure he was having an affair. Tanya's first instinct was that this was going to be a regular case. But then, after a few weeks of investigation, Tanya and her team found that the man was indeed having an affair, but the lady with whom he was having an affair was no ordinary lady. In fact, their investigation seemed to lead to the conclusion that there was a potential killer on the loose.
She had killed her father, her brother, and somebody else in the vicinity there for money, duped them of money, took all their money and ran off.
This is what they suspected from their investigations. But this wasn't information that Tanya could just pass on to her client and then say case closed. The client's husband could potentially be in grave danger.
So initially what started off was a regular investigation only, where we were following her activities and all of that. But then a part of our research team always finds out the background of the person, irrespective of whether the client has asked or not, just through a lot of research online and otherwise. So that is when we just got to know of it, and we got to know of her name and a certain things that she had done. We thought she was a small-time goon, you know, must have committed a few thefts here and there. But then we realized that it could be more, because there was a certain piece of news about her. And that's when we went to the police, verified it with them, took them and our team. Usually we don't also work with the police, but there we had to tie up with the police to get more information about her, because they had more records about her. What we could only find out was very superficial, upar se.
When Tanya's team approached the police with what they'd unearthed, the police were also shocked. They'd been looking for this woman for a while now, and Tanya's information could actually help their investigation.
She had just changed her name. She had changed all of her connections. Any people who she knew in the past weren't anywhere close to her. So it was, again, something that sounded very filmy, but it wasn't.
Tanya then asked her client to bring her husband to the office.
And she said, no, he'll kill me if he gets to know that I'm getting an investigation. We said, no, nothing of that sort will happen. Just get him.
The woman brought her husband, and Tanya told the couple the entire saga.
And he literally lied down on the floor, just pleaded us to save him. We obviously had to take the case to the police. They did. I mean, our job was done there, but then they took the case to the police, and then everything was okay. I mean, at least in terms of this woman wasn't in his life anymore after a point.
The police managed to track the woman down and arrest her. After listening to this story, I had to ask Tanya a question that had been bothering me from the start. What is the impact of seeing people lie to, hide from, and cheat on each other? How does that psychologically affect her?
Does your faith in humanity falter when you see some of the cases?
Yes, sometimes. Never thought about it, but yes, sometimes I do feel like, why did this person have to go? Because, you know, through the case, you also get to know the person who's come to give you the case. It is a long process. They talk about themselves. They talk about the family. So you feel emotional about that. You feel like, why did the person have to go? But at the same time, I feel like it's also restored in a way that, I mean, you will always find out the truth. You do. It might be in a month or later, but you get to know the truth, and the truth in itself helps you tide through that life, you know? I mean, so I feel like nothing, humanity is not lost. It's just that you get onto better things. If you end up losing one person, as in your partner, and you go your separate ways, there's always something better coming for you. So I feel that it's like that. I don't see it in a negative light. I see that it's something better will come for you. It's okay.
Tanya's father taught her pretty early in her career that she has got to ensure that she never brings her work home. And that's hard to do. It's like watching and even playing a role in an immersive dramatic situation and then switching it off and returning to your regular life. Kind of like role play, in a way.
I carry the people with me. I don't carry the outcomes of the cases with me, because every time I think of why I'm doing what I'm doing, despite the hardships, sometimes hardships being, yes, the overheightened emotions or the results not coming, you know, or not as expected by people, I just feel that I'm making someone's life better for sure. It might not feel at that moment, but in the long run, it'll be beneficial for them. Why be with someone who's cheating on you, or why be with someone who hits you or just is not fair to you or doesn't respect you? It hurts in that moment. So sometimes I would just tell myself that I've helped someone and they'll go through it. And if they do want to come back to me to talk to me or just, you know, sometimes look for answers, I can be there in whatever capacity. But yeah, so it helps me just let the case be that then. I always keep the people with me, though.
I have been asking myself, if I was in Tanya's shoes, would my work, all the craziness that I see going on with people's lives, make me more of a suspicious person? And I'm not sure. So I asked Tanya the same question. Has she become more suspicious as a person over the years? And she said no. In fact, she's become the person who thinks that everything's got a reason. If that reason isn't apparent immediately, you've just got to dig deeper. The question, I guess, is if you're ready to see and come to terms with what you're going to eventually find out. As Tanya says, everybody has a secret, after all. In the next episode of Kalki Presents My Indian Life, here's one of India's most popular game streamers. His YouTube channel has nearly 33 million subscribers. And yet, no one really knows who he is or how he even looks.
I really think I know what Spider-Man goes through. He's also someone whose real identity is hidden from the world. His girlfriend and his best friend are the only two people who know who he really is. If I get married, then my wife will be the only other person who knows my real identity.
Kalki Presents My Indian Life is an All Things Small production for the BBC World Service. I really hope you've enjoyed listening to this first episode of Season 3 of My Indian Life. It's so great to be back with a new set of fascinating stories from all over India. If you're listening to this on a podcast app, if there is a subscribe or follow button, please do press it. Let us know what you think. You can find us on BBC World Service on Twitter and Facebook, or use the hashtag MyIndianLife with your comments and suggestions. And please, if you like this episode, help spread the word about our podcast to your friends and family. It'll make us incredibly happy. See you next time. Thanks for listening.